thoughtful reflection on the personalities and the events surrounding the crucifixion of Jesus. It's a beautiful day outside. Glad that you can join us. And tonight, as you hear the music, you'll be hearing the voice of Lindsey Mills and her piano and her song compositions. When I knew her in college, she was Lindsey Longo. I didn't know that we would be marrying into the same family. Amen. And seeing each other, you know, at family reunions for the rest of our lives. Amen. And so that is great. And but something out of the ordinary happened about a year and a half ago when Lindsey started composing music. And so when I was over at their house from time to time and visiting, I got to hear these pieces that were being developed. And you're going to hear some of that tonight. You will be hearing a story, probably, definitely, the most important story ever told. And as you listen tonight, you're not only going to be listening to some fantastic music, but to some very thoughtful theological reflections, which was some of the conversations I had at their house, not just about the music being written, but about the words going along with the music and with the stories being told. And tonight is going to be one of those experiences where I believe you're going to be hanging on to the meaning of every word being shared and exactly what happened. So before we begin the story, let us bow our heads. There's more seats in the front for those that are coming in. Just come right on, make yourselves right at home. We have plenty of seats in the front. You can come up, and we have the windows open this evening so we can enjoy a little bit of the outside air inside. And I invite you to bow your heads so that we may begin by praying to the one whom this house is dedicated to. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the great gift that you have poured out upon us in giving us your own Son as a sacrifice for our sins and for showing us the way, for giving us a future and a hope. May we be touched, may we see something new, deeper tonight as we reflect on the great gift that you have given to us. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
All of you will be made to stumble because of me this night, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been risen, I will go before you to Galilee. Peter answered and said to him, even if all are made to stumble because of you, I will never be made to stumble. Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you that this night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. Peter said to him, even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. And so said all the disciples.
Though all would forsake you, it never would be me. I'll suffer and die with you before doing such a thing. And though all are offended, I will be right by your side. You can depend on me, dear Lord, your name I won't deny. I will drink of the cup that your Father has given, and I will be baptized in your sufferings. I will fight for your kingdom, for I believe you're God's Son. Just ask me what you want, dear Lord, and I will get it done. It never would be me. I'll suffer and die with you before doing such a thing. And though all are offended, I will be right by your side. You can depend on me, dear Lord, your name I won't deny.
Then they came to a place which was named Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he took Peter, James, and John with him, and he began to tremble and be deeply distressed. Then he said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch." He went a little farther and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. This cup take away from me. Nevertheless, what I will, but what you will." Then he came and found them sleeping and said to Peter, "Simon, are you sleeping? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again he went away and prayed and spoke the same words. And when he returned, he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. And then he came the third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." What is this cup? Psalm 75 and verse 8 says, "For in the hand of the Lord there is a cup, and the wine is red. It is fully mixed, and he pours it out. Surely its dregs shall all the wicked of the earth drain and drink down." Isaiah 51 and verse 17 says, "Awake, awake, stand up, O Jerusalem, you who have drunk at the hand of the Lord the cup of his fury. You have drunk the dregs of the cup of trembling and drained it out." And finally, in Revelation chapter 16 and verse 19, it says, "Now the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon was remembered before God to give her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath." The cup that Jesus was about to drink was the wine of the wrath of God that all would have to drink if Jesus had not taken it for us. But now he has taken that cup so that we might never have to experience the eternal separation from God.
More earnest. earnestly to Jesus pray. My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but thy will be done. As the darkness deepens round the Savior's form, he longs for earthly friends. The battle rages o'er our world's fate. Jesus is the only hope for our salvation. He chose to bear our sins. He would not turn away, become the curse of sin for us. While we scorned his selfless way, even his disciples were sleeping when he said to watch and pray. He comes to them now to say, could you not watch with me 1 hour? Sleep on now. Take your rest. The hour is at hand.
In John chapter 18, we read, "Then the detachment of troops and the captain and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him, and they led him away to Annas first, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. Now it was Caiaphas who had advised the Jews that it was expedient that one man should die for the people. When Caiaphas couldn't come up with a good accusation, when Annas couldn't come up with a good accusation, they took him to Caiaphas," which is where we pick up our story again in Matthew chapter 26. "Now the chief priests, the elders, and all the council sought testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but found none. Even though many false witnesses came forward, they found none. But at last, two false witnesses came forward and said, 'This fellow said, I'm able to destroy the temple of God and build it in 3 days.' And the high priest arose and said to him, 'Do you answer nothing what these men testify against you?' But Jesus kept silent. And the high priest answered and said to him, 'I put you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God.' Jesus answered him, 'It is as you said. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter, you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven.' Then the high priest tore his clothes, saying, 'He has spoken blasphemy. What further need do we have of witnesses? Look, now you've heard his blasphemy. What do you think?' They answered and said, 'He is deserving of death.'" God had given the Jews a law, saying that the high priest should not tear his robes, and if he did, it was considered blasphemy and worthy of death. However, tradition had been introduced saying that in the case of someone committing blasphemy, it was acceptable for the high priest to tear his robe. And so, in tearing his priestly robes, Caiaphas was actually condemning himself as worthy of death.
When I wrote the next song about the interaction between Jesus and Caiaphas, I imagined the tables turned. I imagined Caiaphas being on trial and being questioned by Jesus. Jesus saying, "Caiaphas, what have you done in the darkest night to God's Son? This is your hour and the power of darkness." O Caiaphas, what have you done in the darkest night to God's Son? This is your hour and the power of darkness. Is full. He is the high priest. He is the Lamb. He is the Son of God, the great I Am. And though right now you stand as judge, one day he'll come again, and you will stand before Caiaphas. Your lot is cast, your nation's fate determined at last. This is your hour and the power of darkness.
Now Peter sat outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him, saying, "You also were with Jesus of Galilee." But he denied it before them all, saying, "I do not know what you are saying." And when he had gone out to the gateway, another girl saw him and said to those who were there, "This fellow also was with Jesus of Nazareth." But again he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." A little later, those who stood by came up and said to Peter, "Surely you also are one of them, for your speech betrays you." Then he began to curse and swear, saying, "I do not know the man." Immediately a rooster crowed. And Peter remembered the words of Jesus who had said to him, "Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times." So he went out and wept bitterly.
As I entered the court where Jesus was tried, I mingled with the crowd. I tried to look careless, unconcerned, as insults swirled around. But at times I couldn't help the indignation that arose as I saw what took place. As sorrow and dejection filled my heart, a girl's eyes searched my face. on me. I was startled, confused, so I quickly gave a reply. I tried to sound convincing, so I cursed and swore, and my Lord, I did deny. Then the cock crowed in the yard. I realized what just took place. Sorrow, horror, and anguish filled my heart as Jesus' eyes searched my face. Are you not with me? Are you not my disciple? I prayed for you when you were in the garden with me. Gethsemane. My pride was broken, my heart was crushed at the thought of his suffering face, those quivering lips, his eyes brimming with compassion and forgiveness.
There are times we all face a decision. Will we honor God and do right, or compromise to please others? Pilate found himself unexpectedly in this position. He thought that by sacrificing Jesus, he would be able to retain his power and position. But not long after, his position and honor were stripped from him, and a Greek historian recorded that he ended his own life.
When I was thinking about this song, actually, it was partially inspired by Joe Reeves, who's the associate pastor here. He was sitting in our living room, and we were talking about what it would have been like for Pilate. I kind of feel bad for Pilate. And one of the things that Joe brought up was, he said, every time I think of Pilate, I think of this picture. And in the middle of the picture is Pilate. And on one side, he has the crowd crying out, yelling for him to do something. And on the other side, there's Jesus. And he had to make a choice. And that inspired me with the thought, he had to choose between Christ and the crowd. He had to risk his job for justice. He had to turn from truth to satisfy popular demand. He had to sacrifice himself or sacrifice the man. And I imagine walking into the court of Pilate. Soldiers are standing among the pillars by the massive stone walls. The stage is set for the Roman trial of Jesus. And it's Pilate's decision. What will he choose?
Before me in this early morning hour, I thought to do away with him as it was in my power. But then I saw his form so noble. and good and knew he was brought because of jealousy and hatred. I must demand a reason. Why have you brought him here? I find no fault with him. The accusations are unclear. At this, they cried out, he made himself a king. By our law, he ought to die. Crucify him! As the crowd became more frenzied, I knew not what to do. I offered to scourge and free him, but the uproar only grew. Finally, I had him beaten, dressed in a king's attire. But the priests and people did not stop his life, they did desire. Had to sacrifice myself or sacrifice this man. Reason was rejected, passion had its way, as all together shouted, take him away. In spite of my protests, I signed against my will. Jesus would be crucified on Golgotha's hill. I had to choose between Christ and the crowd. Had to sacrifice myself or sacrifice this man. But this man was unlike any I'd seen before. His meekness and patience caused me to marvel. With godlike form, he was silently suffering. Unlike ever before, I felt I had seen a king. I had to choose between Christ and the crowd. I had to risk my job for justice. I chose to turn from truth to satisfy popular. Demand. I would not sacrifice myself, so I sacrificed this man. I sacrificed the man.
So they took Jesus to be crucified. Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and the other on the left. His position indicated that he was the greatest sinner of the three. It reminds me of Galatians 3 and verse 13, where it says that Jesus was made a curse for us. People walked by, taunting and accusing him. So did the robbers, but one was not completely hardened. He had heard of Jesus. He had saw the signs. He had heard the comments of Jesus' followers saying that they thought he was the one who should save Israel? And the Holy Spirit showed him what no one else could see in that hour. Jesus was the Son of God, killed as a slaughtered lamb for his sins.
The next song I'm going to share with you is one of the first ones that I wrote. And this all came about because I was in the car ride on my way home from a wedding, 3 hours away, and I had one CD in the car. And there was one song on the CD that I liked. And so, I didn't have music on my phone because there was no space. So I'm playing this song over and over and over. And it was called When 10,000 Angels Cried. And it's a beautiful song about when Jesus was on the cross, it must have looked like rain when 10,000 angels were crying. And I thought, that is just so powerful. I would love to write a song on angels. And up to this point, I'd been putting some of the Psalms to music, so I was getting into songwriting a little bit. But I thought, I would just love to write an angel song. And then I kept listening to it, and the thought came, another hour, and then the thought came, it would be really neat to have a whole collection of songs on the Crucifixion weekend. I didn't know of anyone that had done that at the time, and there are lots of wonderful songs. Some of my favorite songs are on the Crucifixion events, but there's no collection. And so I decided to go home and start writing a collection of songs. That's how this project got started. And as I went home, my favorite book to read on the subject was The Desire of Ages. And in this book, I started reading about the dying thief. And there was a sentence that stood out to me. The author wrote, "The dying soul cast himself upon the dying Savior and was saved." In that moment of no hope, when the Savior himself is dying, the dying soul cast himself on the Savior and was saved. This is the song of the dying thief.
There was nothing to fear from men. There was nothing more they could do to him. But for the dying thief upon the tree, there was one thing to fear, he knew. The future caused him to tremble. Anguish and despair filled his soul. Condemnation for sins and terror struck within as his life came to a close. The dying soul cast himself upon the dying Savior. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. The words he heard were music to the ears. You will be with me in paradise. He remembered that Jesus had healed. He heard that Christ had forgiven sins. He saw the sign saying, "King of the Jews." He watched the priests mock and jeer. And somehow these things came together as the Spirit illumined his mind. In Christ on the cross, himself upon the dying Savior. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. The words he heard were music to his ears. You will be with me in paradise. At that moment, hope thrilled through his soul. A bright and living light pierced through the darkness of the cloud. Upon the living Savior. Say, remember me when you come into your kingdom. The words you hear are music to the ears. You will be with me. You will be with me in paradise.
Son of Man hangs on the cross. Have you ever felt alone? Does it ever seem like God is quiet? Have you cried out in the silence and the emptiness of the sky only to hear the echo of your own voice? Jesus on the cross felt this way as he said, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
This was taken directly from Psalm 22, the King James Version, if you'd like to follow along. When Jesus said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" It was typical for Jewish rabbis in those days to say the first phrase of a passage of Scripture, and it would point people's minds back to the whole passage. And so when Jesus was crying this, yes, this was his feeling, but he was pointing people back to recognize that this was what the Messiah must pass through. This was the depths of agony that he felt.
My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from heaven? God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season am not silent, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of trusted in thee. They trusted and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee and were delivered. They trusted in thee and weren't confounded. But I am a worm and no man, a reproach. despised of the people. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip and shake their head, saying, he trusted on the Lord to deliver him. Let him deliver him, since he delighted in him. But thou art he that took me out of the womb. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help me. They pierced my hands and my feet. They part my garments among them, and cast lots upon my vesture. But I will declare thy name unto my brethren. My praise shall be
about what it must have been like in heaven in those hours and moments, the dark morning, Sunday morning, before Christ was resurrected. And this was supposed to be my angel song. It morphed beyond that. But I can just imagine all of the angels sitting at the edge of their seats, looking to the Father, eyes on him expectantly, like, is it time? Is it time? Just give us the signal. Like, when is it going to happen? They know that Christ is going to rise again. And so their muscles must have been tensed, ready to spring into action as soon as the Father gave that signal, that look, saying, okay, it's time. And I was sitting in my living room thinking about this song and thinking about those emotions that must have been experienced. And the whole goal of this project was to make the music, was to have the music put emotion to the concepts. And I remember sitting there thinking, what would really capture this? How can we really capture this? And I thought, I wish that the Hallelujah Chorus hadn't been written, because I want the Hallelujah Chorus in my collection. But it had been written, and I'm not sure I could have come up with something that divine anyway. So I sat there thinking and praying, and I started to write. And as I wrote, and as I thought, as I wrote, melody just started to come to mind. And I thought, wow, that's so perfect. That's not quite a chorus. It's not quite a verse. But I'm going to keep it, because that's cool. And I kept writing, and words, thoughts, and music just kept coming. And I got my hallelujahs in here. It's a celebration song, because Jesus is alive. And this song hopefully will capture just a little bit of the essence of the celebration that heaven must have experienced. This is the song of the morning star.
Anticipation reigns as angels watch the Father's face, waiting for some look or sign, telling them that it is time. Everything is dark and still, and silence rests on every hill, listening for the Father's voice to give them reason to rejoice. All heaven awaits the rising of the morning star. Roll away the stone, my son is conqueror. The grave, death has lost its power. Christ has won the right, the world to save. Let the angel choir sing, make the heavenly arches ring. Hallelujah, Hosanna in the highest. Jesus is risen from the grave. Hallelujah, glory to our sight of one heavenly being. Then they watch in terror as they see the immortal King coming forth from death's dark door into life forevermore. Hallelujah, Hosanna in the highest. Jesus is risen from the grave. Strength and power, blessing, honor, wisdom be to him who lives forever, Lord of Lords and King of Kings, ruler over everything. Hallelujah, Hosanna in the highest. Jesus is risen from the grave. Hallelujah, glory to praise. Hallelujah, Hosanna.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And if you didn't know already, here on my left, reading behind the podium tonight, has been Pastor Philip Mills, husband of Lindsey, pastor of Fair Plain Church in Coloma and Hartford, Indonesian. And I assure you that this pastoral couple is using all of their energies and talents to lift up the name of Jesus. They are going in May to Europe, working on a documentary series on the Protestant Reformation, this year being the 500-year anniversary. And just before coming up here, Lindsey says that she's already working on her next story. And I think that might be coming out sometime, the story of Joseph. If you want updates, but maybe I'm getting ahead of myself, because first of all, she is preparing, collecting equipment so she can release an album of what she's been sharing tonight, and that you can share those with friends. If you'd like to support, you can do that when they take up the offering during the next song. And when you leave this evening, I have some clipboards out when you leave after the closing prayer, and you can put your name and your email if you would like updates when the album is released or when there are new concerts. And I also couldn't resist sneaking back into my office and pulling the painting off the wall. I'm not sure if I've showed it to you, of a pilot standing there and looking between Jesus and the crowd and making the decision of which one he was going for. I hang that in my office to remind me every day of the decision that I am also making between Jesus and the crowd. So that painting I put out there so that you can see it on the way out, also right underneath the sign-up sheets. So I invite you to enjoy these last few pieces as they collect the offering during the next one, and glory be to God.
Not everything and everyone found the resurrection exciting. Some were downright terrified, and I can imagine the soldiers, once they recovered from the shock, clawing for their spears and running wildly to tell Pilate, looking over their shoulders fearfully as they went. This is the story of the night guard.
Hurry, hurry, run along. I can't believe what we just saw. Did we dream that Jesus is alive? Fear was seen on every face. To Pilate's house we ran in haste to tell him everything that we had seen. Jesus rose, that man that we had killed. He came forth in majesty and glory. We felt the earth beneath us quake. The heavens seemed to shake. He came forth, the Son of God. First we stopped to tell the priests. They did not want the news released and bribed our guards to say that we had slept. The disciples took their Lord away. This to Pilate we would say, in exchange for coins and safety for our lives. Jesus rose, that man that we had killed. He came forth in majesty and glory. We felt the earth beneath us quake. The heavens seemed to shake. He came forth, the Son of God. Hurry, hurry, run along. I can't believe what we just saw. Did we dream that Jesus is alive? Fear was seen on every face. To Pilate's house we ran in haste to tell him everything that we had seen. Jesus rose, that man that we had killed. He came forth in majesty and glory.
This last song that I'm going to share with you, I think, encapsulates the gospel message. And it's the song of Mary. He was the only one that had believed in her. He was the only one that showed her that there was hope. And when she lost Jesus, she had lost her Lord. But to make matters worse, she goes to the tomb Sunday morning to go and anoint his body, and she's lost him again. And I can imagine her heart's cry and the tears in her eyes as she says, "Where is my Lord? Where have you laid him? Please tell me now, and I will take him. I will take him away. Please tell me, I pray. How can I face another day?" And in the middle of the song, there's a turning point. There's a point at which she looks up and she sees Jesus, that he is standing right beside her. And through her tears, she recognizes the one who's believed in her, and she's found her Lord. And my prayer for each of us this evening is that we will find our Lord. If we've wandered away, if we feel like our night is dark and like there's nothing to hope for, that this song will speak to our hearts. This is the song of Mary.
I reached the tomb as dawn began to break. To my surprise, the stone was rolled away. No soldiers were around. My heart began to pound. I've lost my Lord again this day. Tell me now, to whom you gave him, and I will take him away. Please tell me, I pray, how can I face another day? Two angels in the tomb were dressed in white. I turned from them into the morning light. The gardener stood there, perhaps he knew where they took my Lord during the night. Where is my Lord? Where have you laid him? Please tell me now, to whom you gave him, and I will take him away. Please tell me, I pray, how can I face another day? Oh.
My prayer is that through this collection of songs, that each of you were drawn closer to Jesus. And I pray that if you've wandered, that you've found your Lord tonight. Let's close with prayer, and then you can all be dismissed. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the gift of Jesus. We thank you for the sufferings that he endured on our behalf so we wouldn't have to. We thank you for his mercy, compassion, and forgiveness. And I pray that you would draw us close to yourself, whatever person we may identify with in this story, that you will give us a new start, and that this week we will walk with you, having found our Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You're dismissed.